2024. Good morning, one and all. I, Professor Anjali Vaghmare, welcome you on fourth day of FE induction program of Pune Vidyarthigrahas College of Engineering and Technology and G.K. Patiwani Institute of Management, Pune. Speaker for today's talk is Dr. Mrs. Gitanjali Vaidya. Ma'am, she is professor in Electrical Engineering Department since August 1988. She did her PhD in Electrical Engineering. Her industrial experience is of 4.5 years and teaching experience of 32 years. She has received number of awards. She has received Adarsh Shikshan Puraskar Award. Recently, ma'am is recipient of Outstanding Engineer Award from IEEE Power and Energy Chapter. She is also a recognized guide of SPPU in Electrical Department. Her publication contribution is about 40 papers, 4 books of electrical engineering. Ma'am is also a central committee member of Arogya Sena, a social organization. So today she is going to deliver a talk on disaster management, medical relief work. Now may I request ma'am to take over the charge. Gitanjali Vaidya ma'am.
Good morning, dear students, and a warm welcome to you all for this induction program organized by PVG's College of Engineering and Technology and G.K. Patiwani Institute of Management. Induction program is organized to learn beyond the classroom and students to be familiar with the various issues in the society, various sensitive issues in the society. And the disaster management subject is very much relevant in the current pandemic situation of COVID-19 in the country which all of us are facing. Not only our country, but the whole world is facing the pandemic situation of COVID-19. Disaster management remains neglected subject even in the country like ours, which faces many natural and the man-made disasters. Even today, we do not have well-coordinated National Disaster Management Network, which actually works during the calamities, during the disasters, natural and the man-made. And the medical aid is the first thing which is required after any disaster. And medical aid during the first hour can save majority of the lives. And so this disaster management subject is of great significance. And I'll be talking in brief on the disaster management today, as this is a subject having a wide spectrum and the coverage is also very wide coverage for this subject. There are two types of disasters, natural and man-made disasters. Mankind has to face various natural disasters like earthquakes, floods, cyclones, heavy rainfalls, forest fires, volcanoes, heavy snowfall, avalanche, cloudburst, landslides, epidemics and famines. And these disasters, they devastate everything. So preventing disasters, preventing especially the natural disasters, is out of the reach of the man. However, the loss of lives and the saving of loss of lives can be possible by working in the disasters, by efficient network of the disaster management. These famines, epidemics and the global warming, these are natural disasters as well as man-made disasters also to some extent. Accidents, fires, terrorist attacks, wars, riots, stampede, food poisoning, they are some examples of the man-made disasters. These are personal calamities which we are facing in our day-to-day life. fractures, hemorrhage, heat stroke, food poisoning, snake bite in the rural area, scorpion bite, electric shocks, feats, eye injury, and there are so many other calamities which cannot be listed here. And this presentation will not include the personal calamities or how to react in the personal calamities or respond in the personal calamities, as the disaster management itself is a subject, it is a huge subject. In the sea, due to earthquake, volcano. See, these are just the movie clips. You must also have seen many disasters in many movies. However, when actually this happens, the situation can be many times worse. It is devastating, total devastating. And therefore, the disaster management network is a must everywhere. In last 100 years, 60% of the natural disasters have hit Asia. Out of this, 55% natural disasters have hit India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, and Sri Lanka. And our country, India, is disaster prone, especially many states such as Maharashtra, Gujarat, and the West Bengal, they are the most disaster prone states. Cyclone, drought, earthquake, floods are the main disaster hitting in our country. And others which we have faced are tsunami, avalanche in some areas, landslides, and also cloudburst. 68% of India is a drought prone area. 59% is earthquake prone and 8% is flood prone area. Yearly losses due to the disasters, statistics is given here. 60,000 lives are lost in the natural disaster every year. 70,000 lives are lost in the road accidents every year. 15,000 lives in rail accidents, and thereby 2% GDP is lost every year. So to meet this challenge, we need to have an efficient and workable disaster management system. These are the four pillars of disaster management. The whole disaster management depends on these four pillars. Planning, response. First picture is the picture which I have taken from the Maharashtra itself during the flood situation. And in the remote area of the Kashmir, in the Isham area, the patients are shifted from the jute beds. In Marathi, it is called as khatas. So they are shifted like this. And so this kind of situation is still there. You might not be aware, because we stay in the cities, we stay in the urban areas. In the rural areas, they are struggling for the day-to-day life, for water, for electricity, for the food, for shelter. They have to struggle hard. Even for education, they have to struggle hard. And when disaster takes place, it becomes very, very difficult for children, for people to cope up with the disaster. So second pillar of the disaster management is the response. The response should be very fast. It should shelter their homes, and they are homeless now, and so family survival kits are needed to be given to them. Now here you can see that the computerized disaster management system, where many decisions regarding the response are taken in such a control room. Few equipments are used for the search and the rescue of the victims or the patients. Just to name a few, these are the sound-based trapped person locator. We are going to see what it is. So with the help of sound waves, it is possible to find the person trapped below the debris. It is possible to see a trapped person with the help of fiber optics video probe, and it is possible to identify the living person with the or color monitor, where you can see whether anyone is trapped below the debris. You can see here a person is trapped below the debris. So if it is seen there on the camera, that debris, it can be removed. Otherwise, there are piles of debris, and the huge piles So one may not know what is to be removed and what is not to be removed. So these kinds of equipments are to be employed there. Thermal imaging camera is also employed for locating, for identifying whether the person is live or dead. Gas cutters and dog squads are used also for identifying victims, for identifying if anyone is trapped below the debris. That is possible there. Advanced equipments, these are robots, you can see here. They are graphene 1, 2 and 3. They are completely automated, controlled by the radio signals. With the field arm, they are employed for the identifying the victims trapped under the debris. Satellite communication devices are seen here, which are needed during the disaster. Walkie-talkie, VHF radio, mobile, satellite communication is needed. So in a nutshell, these are the hi-fi advanced devices and equipments which are to be employed whenever disaster happens immediately for locating, for identifying victims and for taking them for the treatment further. These victims which are identified, who are live victims, they are taken to the hospitals, they are taken to the trauma centers quickly by such ambulances which are seen here. Even this helicopter is an ambulance only. This is a one picture of trauma center after the disaster, happening of the disaster, where the doctors and team of surgeons operate this if needed, and further medical treatment if it is to be provided there. Arogya Sena is formed by Dr. Abhijit Vaidya, and these are the team equipments which are displayed here, which are identified by the Arogya Sena, which is formed before more than 30 years for the disaster management. And whenever there is a disaster in this country, whenever there is a calamity, huge calamity in the country, Arogya Sena has reached there for the medical relief work, for the treatment of the patients, and for the medical work. These are the few team equipments which Arogya Sainiks have to carry, because when they go for the disaster management and medical relief work, they need to carry, they have to stay there for few days, then they need to carry these equipments for themselves. They have to keep this treatment box for the patients, dressing box, which includes mask, gloves, ointments, sterile pads, scissors, bandages, eye pad for the eye injury if any, and other small devices. Medical aid is necessary, and many medicines which are systematically, they are categorized here, which are seen here, depending on the disaster, depending on the calamity, these medicines quantities, they are taken in huge quantities at the site of the disaster, at the place of the calamity. And these medicines, depending on the illness and the depending on the situation of the patient, they are given to the patients and the victims. These are the teams, Arogya Sena teams in the various disasters are seen here in the Kerala, in Kashmir and in Maharashtra and other states. In foreign countries, the team, disaster management team, they have their own chartered planes or boats. They are going for the disaster management. They consist of the physicians, surgeon, doctors, nurses, and the volunteers. See this golden hour, this is a medical concept here. Golden hour is a medical aid within 1 hour after any disaster, which can save the lives of majority of the victims. So this period is known as a golden hour, and this period is 1 hour, 0 to 1 hour, less than 1 hour. So if the medical aid reaches the victim within 1 hour of the disaster, there are chances of the survival. Dr. Vaidya has, however, classified the late responses also. Golden period is 1 to 3 hours, silver period is 3 to 24 hours, and bronze period is 1 to 5 days also. So as early the medical aid is received, the speedy recovery of the patient will be resulted. There are many challenges in the disaster management. We are still discussing the response. That is a second pillar of the disaster management. Wounds, burns, fractures, dislocations are there, sprains, infections, tetanus, gangrene, epidemics may result after the disaster. It may happen after floods, there are epidemics. After floods, maybe there are gastro. Respiratory infections, gastrointestinal infections, leptospirosis may be there if the floods are there, because these bacteria or viruses, they can cause the infections, and therefore these are all medical challenges. There are a few pre-existing illnesses to few victims or the patients, such as asthma, epilepsy, blood pressure, etc. So this again mass casualty event or the incidence, what is a mass casualty event? When three or more people, they are affected by a disaster, it is called as a mass casualty. If one person or two persons are there, road accident of 1% is not a mass casualty. Minimum 3 persons, if they are affected, it is a mass casualty incident or mass casualty event. They are categorized as, when 3 to 10 people are affected, it is a car, during, say the examples are car crash, house collapse, etc. It is a minor MCI. Major MCI and mega MCI greater than 10 and 1000 includes the examples of earthquakes, floods, hurricanes, where more than many people, they are affected and they are encountered in the disaster and in the huge calamities. It is a mass casualty incidence. Now this is a basic chain. First, the patients are to be searched, then rescued, then triage is to be provided. Triage is the sorting of the patients. Means you have to sort out the patients, which patient is the serious patient and which patient is non-serious patient, so that the action can be taken accordingly. And then once the triage is done, that is sorting of the patient, the first aid is immediately provided and they are taken for the hospital treatment or the trauma center treatment or the primary health care center treatment, depending on the area, depending on the medical situation of the patient. So what is triage? See, this triage is a French word that is sorting. Triage, meaning of triage is sorting. So patients are to be sorted out. Okay. So they are sorted out as per the seriousness, as per the critical conditions of the patients. And there are three priorities. They are classified in the four, but one last one is a priority zero. In brief, we will see what are these three priorities. Priority one, red tag means extremely serious patients. Priority two, yellow tag, they are to be tagged by yellow color if they are serious, but they are not extremely serious or critical patients. Green tag means they are not serious patient at all, but they have some minor injuries. And black tag means they are critical, extremely serious patients who cannot be treated. Even if they are treated immediately, the survival is 0%. So priority one, it is a topmost priority patients where the BP is very low, pulse is very low. Breathing difficulty, respiratory arrest is there, severe bleeding is there, hemorrhage is there, cardiac arrest, patient has gone into the cardiac arrest and immediate treatment is needed. You can see the patient, this red color, this tag officer is treating here, this immediately. Shock, hypothermia, these are all medical few terminologies, and so This will not be discussed, of course, here. But these are extremely serious or critical patients which are to be treated on the topmost priority. And so these are called as a priority one victims or priority one patients. Priority two, these patients can be treated or attention can be given after red tag patient means priority one patients. So convulsions, stable abdominal injuries, eye injuries are there, uncomplicated burns are there, but they are uncomplicated burns. These are all patients with priority 2. Okay, and so they are to be treated after priority 1 patients. Priority 3, these are not at all serious patients. However, they have minor fractures, sprains, burns. They can be treated at a later stage after treating priority 1 and priority 2 patients. Priority 0, these are the, means you can see the patient pulse is not there. They are dead patients. They are fatal. They have fatal injuries. Their vital organs such as heart, lung, they are means you can see their vital organs out of the body. And so this cannot be treated. They have fatal injuries. And these are all priority zero patients. So those organs are hanging out and they cannot be saved under any situations. So these patients are to be tagged with the black ribbon, and so that nobody will go to these patients as they are dead patients or they cannot be saved. There is a 0% chance of saving these patients. So this is an immediate treatment manager who can treat immediately, delayed treatment management, after immediate treatment management, and the minor treatment management. The green color is shown there for the minor treatment management. Whenever a medical team reaches at the disaster site, you can see that this is a triage officer. We can see this is a triage officer in our country here. You can see he has a megaphone and he appeals people to get up. Those people who can get up and minor injuries, they are identified with the green tags. Okay, they are identified with the green tags. They are tied green tags, and then rest of the victims or the patients, depending on the situation, they are tied with the red tags or yellow tags. Or yellow tags. Then airlifting is done. This is the reality from the advanced countries. Immediately after putting the tags, the airlifting is done in other advanced countries, and this is the reality from our countries. However, we really salute our Sainiks because they work against all odds, against all worst situations. They are ready to work in all disasters. And so we really salute our Sainiks who really contribute in the disaster management and the all calamities whenever they take place, wherever they take place in the country. What should be the medical knowledge for the triage? Basically, this triage is means common people, even today's youths, they also can involve in the triage. They also can involve in the triage. This medical knowledge with the which medical students they acquire in the medical colleges is not needed here. That is a different medical knowledge which is needed for the triage, which you also can contribute there. Young youths, energetic youths, they can contribute in the disaster, in the triage, and they can reduce the burden on the disaster management system as well. So primary survey is to be carried out. We will see what is the primary survey in brief. Vital signs are to be checked. We can check the vital signs and head to toe examination. So no doctor is needed for this primary survey, vital signs, or head to toe examination. Any common person who is trained for the disaster management, for the triage, for such medical examination in the disaster, can work for the triage, can work in the disaster. So what are the primary surveys? It is a stepwise surveys done responsive airways, breathing, circulation and the hemorrhage. These are the primary survey which anyone can carry out. You can see here, these are five steps. RABCH, response, airways, breathing, circulation and hemorrhage. Now response means, if you see the victim, ask him, are you okay? Are you okay? So if he responds, means he is alive. He is alive. That is the first step here. Don't move or shake head or neck, because that victim may have cervical injury. If that head or neck is shaken, then injury may increase there. And therefore, the shoulder is to be shaken and asked, it is to be asked, are you okay? So the check whether the victim responds there. Second is airway. You can see here with the left hand, the head is tilted and chin is lifted here. So that airway becomes clear. Many times it happens that the airway is not clear and there is a difficulty in breathing. So in that situation, the airway is cleared. Okay. So shift this head below and lift this chin so that airway is cleared. And but check that whether tongue is not there in between the airway. Okay, that has to be checked there. Feel whether the breathing is there for the patient. Check the movement of the chest, abdomen, and feel whether the breathing is continuous. So if the breathing is continuous, means the person is alive. You can check the circulation, means it is our, say, pulse examination, you can say. You can see here, this is a carotid pulse. Okay. Now radial pulse is this pulse. Okay, this is a radial pulse. Carotid pulse means you can also check. This is carotid pulse, means three fingers are to be taken. And this three fingers in the line of the neck below this, you can keep here these three fingers and feel your pulse. You can feel your pulse. That this pulse is a carotid pulse. Check it now. You can do it if your pulse is continuous. So your pulse should be for the breathing also, you can see, or pulse also you can check for the patients, and hemorrhage also. Now heavy bleeding, you can see whether some bleeding is there. Bleeding is there. So these are the five steps of the primary survey: response, airways, breathing, circulation and the hemorrhage. Quickly these primary survey is to be carried out. Okay, quickly these are to be carried out. So breathing should be 18. You can check whether breathing is fast or very slow. Per minute it should be 18. Okay, 18 breaths should be there per minute. So 4 to 5 breaths in the 15 seconds. 4 to 5 breaths in 15 seconds should be there. And pulse rate should be 72 per minute. 72 per minute it should be there. So if it is too fast or too slow, then there is some abnormal condition. Vital signs. Again, pulse rate, respiration, temperature, blood pressure is to be seen quickly. These are the vital signs. Pulse, radial pulse, carotid pulse. Now it may happen that it is not possible, only foot is outside the debris. Then how to check the pulse? Then there is a dorsalis pulse, which you can check on the person's foot. So you can feel that pulse there. So it is not possible in some of the cases to check the radial pulse or carotid pulse. Then that dorsalis pulse also can be checked. Respiration, temperature and the blood pressure. Head to toe examination, this is again different. See, we will not go into the details. Here suppose, you can see here, this examination you can carry out. If this white area is there after pressing this, then it is a normal sign. Otherwise, some internal bleeding is there. So this is a BLS algorithm, unresponsiveness, then shout for help, open airway, breathing normally, call emergency medical services, 100 chest compressions and 2 rescue breaths are to be given. That we will see. This is a rescue breathing. to rescue breathing means this is a artificial breathing. How it is to be given, literature is, medical literature is also available, how it is to be given. And here this is a BLS or basic life support. Now as per the medical guidelines, even if only this chest compressions are given, it is sufficient. Now in their protocols, but chest compressions should be very, very fast. Chest compressions should be very, very fast. So in 1 minute, there should be many chest compressions which are specified this as per the protocol. Maybe around 20-30 chest compressions are needed, and upstroke and downstroke, it should go below the 2 inches, right? So you can see here how it is to be pressed here like this, and the chest compressions are given like this. The speed you can see here for the chest compressions. In the Arogya Sena training, this training is given with the help of the doll. This how the chest compressions are given, how the breathing and the chest compressions are given. See when how to move and rescue the victim. When one person is available, when the drags are available, when they are not available, when two or three persons are available. See when only one person is available, you can see how to rescue the patient without creating the injury to the patient. So they can be moved like this when only one person is available. When two persons are available, you can see how they are moved. These methods, all these methods, they are named. There are some medical names for this, rescuing the patients, right? And when the drag is available, that is, it is not possible to lift the patient, then in that case, if the patient is unconscious, then patient can be dragged like this. So if the stretcher is available, the patients can be shifted like this. Now we have discussed in very brief, the second pillar, that is a response. The third pillar of the disaster management is recovery. Quickly, some challenges of the recovery I will touch upon here. Recovery means the removal of the debris. Clean food and water is needed to be given. Temporary shelter is to be provided. Sewage disposal system is to be provided there, and the human and animal dead bodies disposal is to be carried out. These are all medical challenges. Hospitalization, then for children, the challenges are, more challenges are there. Psychological problems are there. And so one team will work for the psychological rehabilitation. This is a just few slides of devastation after the disaster. I will show here. This is a tsunami. You must have heard about the tsunami in the 2004 in the south part of our country. Public address system to make aware people about the tsunami is seen here. This is a devastation in the Red Bridge when the Arogya Sena team visited the Kashmir for the medical relief work, earthquake in was devastated. There was a landslide and everything. This is a Mandar Devi stampede. You must have heard in the Maharashtra only. In the stampede, which is a man-made, and so there was a piling up of the dead bodies there. Nagapattinam again after tsunami. And all these agencies are needed there after the disaster. And there should be the good coordination amongst all this: police, home guard, PWD, water works, transport, state electricity. Friends, whenever there was flood disaster in Maharashtra last year, the electricity supply was cut off for few days. And again, that result into the more panic situation there. However, it is necessary to cut off the electricity supply in order to prevent the electric shocks and other calamities. Rehabilitation of the houses, medical, educational. So, children lose their educational material. In the schools, when we had visited in the Kolhapur, we have seen that the whole library was underwater. They lost their numbers of books, hundreds of books. And so educational challenges are also there. Psychological challenges, social challenges are there, and so rehabilitation is needed in all these aspects. Rehabilitation is very important. Now, quickly some do's and don'ts in few disasters. I will just browse through few slides. Now, how earthquake happens and what is that? The technicalities I will omit here. So, for earthquake, the main thing is you need to go to the ground always and take a shelter near the but sit below the table, bed, and cover head with the thick cloth. Cyclones. For the cyclones also go to the basements because many times it happens that the huge structures also they fly off. And stay away from the windows, stay below the table. These are few do's and don'ts in case of few disasters. Teamwork is needed. Switch off the power supply. Floods. So we are habituated with the floods, especially Maharashtra. Every time it happens in the rainy season, try to go to heights. In the floods, when the earthquake happens, go to the ground or the near the ground, and when floods are there, try to go to the heights. Do not drive vehicles on the flooded roads. Do not walk on the roads even after the water subsides. Then or the flood water, as the flood water weakens these roads. Stay away from the electric poles, wires, etc. Switch off the power supplies. There are many reptiles and animals in the Sangli area that happened. Crocodiles, they came out after the floods on the roads, snakes, and so the care is to be taken. Discard flood contaminated flood waters. Check collapse structure with the long sticks. Tsunami. What is tsunami? Tsunami is nothing but the monster waves, very giant waves, because of the earthquake below the sea, below the sea surface. Technical aspect is shown there. And tsunami also, they can be sensed and the people can be made aware of the tsunami in advance. It is possible. So tsunami warning system is seen there. Avalanche also, I will just browse this, because avalanche only in few areas is possible. Okay, there are many disasters where the water rescue is needed, means people are to be rescued from the water. So what are these? Floods. Even cyclones also, because cyclones many times will follow with the floods. Tsunami, boat sinking, ship sinking, vehicular accidents, means vehicles falling in the river, like that we can consider. So drowning rescue, how the drowning rescue has to be carried out. So rescuer must take self-protection precautions first before rescuing other. Must not jump into the water unless a good swimmer, you are a good swimmer. Preferably should tie a rope around the waist or use a float. That is very important. Because panically, if you jump into the water, the person who jumps also may lose the life. So first drowning rescue is the victim is conscious and close to the bank. Then throw some aspect which can be catched by the victim, by the person on the shore, and pull him if the person is near the shore. If the victim is conscious but away from the bank, if the victim is away from the bank, then you cannot the person reach the person, and in that case some object which floats on the water is to be thrown, and that victim can be asked to catch the object. Boats also can be used if they are available. See rain havocs. In the rain havocs, you can see this is a picture of Pune city only last year. Kolhapur, rain havoc in Mumbai, Sangli. See, at a glance you can see how the persons can be rescued from the water. In this picture, just hold him like this, in this position. His nose and face only should be out of the water so that he can breathe very well. However, he should be in this position if some spine injury or cervical spine injury is there till the medical aid reaches, or shift him in this situation. If the electric shock is there, switch off the electric supply immediately without touching the victim. Stand on the some dry object, that is wood, books, pull the person's clothes, and don't touch the hand or say any part of the person. By the wooden stick if possible, check the vital parameters and BLS also if needed. These are few do's for the lightening. Run away from the metallic objects, water or weight objects, open fields, hide in bushes as shown here on the ground, how the person is hiding in case of the lightening. Don't take shelter under the tree or the weak structures. Don't go near the electric current conducting lines or telephones. Don't stand vertically. So treating a lightning victim, safe to handle as do not hold charge. Shift to the safe area. Do not handle the mobile phone also. I think this is missing here because this is a very, very old presentation. I think I need to include this also. You don't have to carry the mobile phone, switch off your mobile, scorpion bite, which otherwise they are included in the training program which is given by the Arogya Sena. So epidemic is the infectious disease which spreads from person to person, caused by bacteria or viruses, and spread through air, water, food, insects, touch or interclosure. It is not a curse of God or goddess. Many people in the rural area, they think that Devi means it is a curse of God or goddess. So it is not like that. It happens. There is a say scientific reason behind that, and we need to understand how it takes place. As I mentioned earlier, the epidemics is man-made to some extent as well as natural also. When it begins, it may be natural, but it can spread widely if the precautions are not taken systematically or in an organized way. Some infectious diseases, you know, all these infectious, some of the infectious diseases like smallpox, plague, you might not have heard also. So these were not there. They are eradicated from the world. Plague, smallpox, because of the vaccines and because of the tireless efforts of the medical workers. But they were there before few decades. Typhoid, gastro, they are epidemics only. Now we have experience, whole world has experience for last few months. I have not included this corona, how it happens, because all of you are very well aware about the corona, what is COVID-19, this is a coronavirus only. It is a one type of virus of the SARS. So one type of virus under the, you can say flu or the swine flu. And this is a mutated version of the corona, that is COVID-19. So you have already experienced what happens when the epidemics is there, and whole world has faced this pandemic. This pandemic has affected our lives also. There are our educational system, all other social systems for laborers. It was a real curse. So all these are epidemics. Even chicken pox also you must not have heard. AIDS, these are all epidemics. You need to identify, prevent, control and educate. Again, these are four pillars of the action plan which I am skipping here. Only educate, how you can participate. You can educate students, student awareness program, you can educate your neighbors, you can educate your family members. If you know few things, you can educate how to act, how to work, how to react, how to respond if something happens. Like suppose if epidemic takes place, how to respond that epidemic. And whole action plan should be based on the scientific points only, not any other point. Famines. You can see famines in Maharashtra, in Vidarbha, Marathwada. There are many times it happens. Famines, and these are the fodder camps. Chara Chavani, they are called in Marathi. So protecting the crops, these are the challenges which farmers are already, they are poor farmers in Maharashtra and they have to face these challenges during the famines along with other people who are facing this. Distribution of the food, grain, water, medical aid, employment, generation, all these aspects are extremely important and they are to be addressed quickly during these disasters. Prevention, planning, water management, forestation. We can see here this is a still reality. School children, they are involved in the filling of the water, right? So food poisoning, again, this is a, I think this can be a personal calamity sometimes, or if it happens in the hundreds, in the marriage ceremony, we heard that many people, they consume some particular say food. Then there are methods to identify which food item has affected or caused the poisoning, right? There are numbers of methods, means the common eating is to be seen, what common food item all those 100 people have, and so you can understand what is the what type of poison it is, and the treatment can be carried out accordingly. So shift to hospital as most need IV medications and the fluids. These are the terror attacks. You are well aware of this attacks, means in the 26/11 in Mumbai, there was a terror attack, and 9/11 in US, you have heard about the terror attacks. Fire. Now, how to protect yourself from the fire? This is a triangle. So either heat, flame or oxygen or fuel, if anything is broken, then the fire triangle is broken and you can prevent the fires. So either you can break the oxygen, either you can prevent the fuel, either you can break the flame which is there. So how it is possible? Now flame is stopped here. How? By the fire extinguisher. How this is to be used? There are many demos of this fire extinguishers. Pull the pin, then extinguisher nozzle, then squeeze it and round it. Sweep the extinguisher from side to side. Then suppose if your clothes catch fire, how to react, how to respond? Then stop immediately, don't run, don't walk, stop immediately, drop here and roll. Okay, that is the action which immediately is to be carried out. Don't run. Suppose if, what to do if the fire breaks out? So if the fire breaks out, get everyone out, close the door to contain the fire, and then call the fire brigade immediately, 101. Do not use lifts, use the stairs, right? And one important thing that which some of you might not be knowing, that if the you are trapped in a you are trapped somewhere, right? And the fire has taken place. So when fire will follow with the smoke. Now the smoke will escape or it will rise above. And near the ground, there is some fresh air or the oxygen. So crawling is preferred there. Crawling keeps your head in the safety zone and away from the smoke's toxic content. And therefore, while crawling, you can move out of that area, and because the more oxygen, fresh air is available near the ground there. So when you are trapped, then you can shout for the help or call for the help, but don't jump out of the building. Help will arrive when you call it. Now, how to judge what is the percentage of the burns? These are the burns. Means you can see here 9%, 9% front, 9% back. So 18%, 18%. This is 36% legs, 9% front, 9% back. So it is again 18%. 36, 18. This is again 18%. Okay. Both legs, both hands, 9%, and rest. This makes 100%. So if the you can find out how much is the percentage of the burns and which organs are burnt, so that that decision can be taken here. How much is the percentage, right? Now when a burn is, this is a degree of burns, you can see here, this is a degree of burns, this is a degree of burns. When it is a deep burn here, this is a superficial burn. So when it is a superficial burn, it is painful to you. When it is a superficial burn, it is a painful. The color is pinkish red and skin graft is not required. Healing will take place in few weeks. However, if it is a deep burn, it will be entire thickness of the skin. You will not have any pain if the burn is deep burn. So we say that the so much of burn, 50%, 80%, but the patient will not feel any pain because it is a painless, right? All the sensors and everything, they are dead in that case. So skin graft is required. Healing will take place more than 4 weeks, many months or the years also. So if the minor burns are there, less than 10%, less than 20% for the adult, then OPD dressing at home is also sufficient. However, if it is at the special site, if it is there, then care of wounds or intubation or ICU care center, the patient has to be shifted. If it is affecting some respiratory burn or other injuries are there. If it is a severe burns, then if it is 20 to 60%, then burn center and IV fluids are to be given. 60% burns is also a very huge amount of burn. And if it is very severe, more than 60, then the chances are very less. These are considered under priority zero. Priority zero means, you know, it is say virtually priority zero or last priority critical patients. Basic life support, IV, cold water is to be cold water. They are to be flooded with the cold water, IV fluids, clean wounds, cover wounds, dressing. This dressing training also you must have, how to carry out the dressings if wounds are there. Because in the earthquake prone area, when you will go, many people, they will have wounds and dressings are needed for many victims or patients. There are many disasters. There are other injuries also. Burn centers are not there. Lacuna in disaster management. After burns, there are accidents, train accidents. Many people lose their lives in the train accidents. There are stampedes, riots, wars. Other wars I have omitted here. Now, Arogya Sainik's training program also includes how to give care wounds, how to care burns, how to care fractures, sprains, dislocations. Very quickly we will browse through this. Clean the wound with the plain water, clean the dirt, use jet of water if possible by syringe, clean and dry the wound and apply antiseptic, tetanus injection also. Bleeding, how to stop bleeding, that is shown here. Then how to carry out the wound dressing is shown here. Treatment of the closed fracture. Ask patient to keep that part steady in case of a fracture. It should not be moved. And some splint is to be given. Splint means some support which is to be given. In Marathi, it is called as Aadhar Fali. So how this is to be given, we will see. Suppose if the injury is there to one finger, another finger where there is no injury, the splint of that finger is to be given here. You can see here, for hand also, the splint means support of this, you can see here, is given here. Then support of this pillow is given here as a splint. Here also the support is given. So how the splint is to be given? Okay, now I will show you few glimpses in very few minutes. We are at the end of the presentation because I could cover few aspects. However, majority of the aspects are uncovered here as this is a very broad spectrum and one complete subject. Disaster management is a very broad area. So Arogya Sena, as I mentioned, it is founded in the 1995 rural medical referral center in the one small village near Parandavadi, Bedse village. And whenever there is some calamity, disaster in the country, Arogya Sena runs there, rushes there for the medical relief work. along with the team of doctors, along with the Arogya Sainiks, along with the medicines worth lakhs of rupees, along with the dressing boxes and other kits, and work in the medical relief work. So it is founded in the 1995, which addresses the other health issues also, public health issues, social issues, and political issues also. Works in the natural and the man-made disasters. In the Latur earthquake, which took place in 1993, the relief work was carried out here in the Latur earthquake. You can see the people here. And then this Arogya Sena was formed after the Latur earthquake. Till then, the Rural Medical Referral Center was working in the disasters. This is a gastro epidemic in the Madgaon, Raigad. In the SARS epidemic, Tsunami Medical Mission in Tamil Nadu, Kerala, in the December 2004 to December January 2005, Kashmir Earthquake Mission in October 2005. In the Isham, you can see they are carrying the medical boxes. They have to walk only. No vehicle can go there. Naribal and Isham. Maharashtra mega floods. They have to go through the boats also. Of course, the corporation, they had provided these boats to the Arogya Sena. Famine in Maharashtra, Sangli. Bihar Kosi flood. Bihar Kosi flood. Orissa flood relief mission in 2008. Chikungunya epidemic, Kerala, in June 2007 and January 2008. Swine flu mission in 2009, 2014 and 2015 in different parts of in Pune also. Fires were there in 2010 in many parts of Pune. So in Ambedkar Vasahat, the medicines are being distributed there. In Leh Ladakh, you can see how beautiful is the Ladakh here. And after devastation, this is the Ladakh which is seen over here. Thane cyclone, Tamil Nadu in 2012. In Nepal earthquake, you can see the Arogya Sena's team working along with the this military soldiers also. They are working there. They help them. Tamil Nadu Kuddalur in 2015. In Kerala, the boxes, medicine boxes are being moved here. Sihangad Road, there was a flood accidentally on one day in 2018. Immediately, team reached there. This Arogya Sena medical team working in flood affected areas last year in August, September, October, from August to October, the in Pune, Kolhapur, Sangli, in the remote areas of Kolhapur, Mauje, Are, in those villages, the team visited for the medical relief work. Now in Corona pandemic 2020 also, the Arogya Sena contributed 85,000 people from 5 states are given free grocery and lunch. Even the sanitizers were distributed to the police force also. Few glimpses are seen here. From 1993 to 2019, more than 95,000 patients are treated. And more than now, this is not updated here. 90 lakhs worth medicines are distributed to people. Without any government aid in any form, it is not taken in any form. No foreign aid is taken in any form. Arogya Sena is not NGO. Our finances come from our well-wishers and us. And this is the dream Arogya Sena. These are few glimpses till 2010 only. So as I mentioned, Arogya Sena works in the 6 states with more than 14,000 volunteers. So whenever disaster happens, all those volunteers quickly they become active and they start work, medical relief work, because they are trained Arogya Sainiks. This is my last slide, students. This is just a very small take-home message for you. I appeal all of you to understand disasters. We should not take it for granted that disasters will not come. Disasters are sudden disasters, and it is necessary to understand, and there are different kind of disasters, and so you need to understand these disasters. You need to have the basic knowledge of disasters. You need to have the mindset to work, to contribute in the disasters, and you need to wish to work in the disasters fearlessly if you have the knowledge, by educating the people, by educating children, by contributing by any ways. So that will help to create the mass movement, and that will definitely change the very face of the disaster management in our country. So this is the only objective of Arogya Sena, to inspire people to take up the medical relief work during the disasters. Students, I request you to narrate your experience. You also must have participated or contributed in the disaster management work or any calamity work. So narrate your experience. If you have participated, if you have contributed in any disaster management work, any medical relief work, and upload your experience on the Google Classroom which is provided to you. You can share your experience with your photos, with your description. So please share it on the Google Classroom. You can contact our first year faculty members for the Google Classroom. They have already created it for you. So please narrate it. And I'm thankful to you for attending this induction program. So these are my contact details, my email IDs. If you have any query, any doubt, because I know that today's session is not the interactive session, otherwise it becomes very much interactive. So you can send me your queries, your questions on my email IDs anytime, and look forward to see you work in the disaster management in our country, in our nation, in our state, and in our home also. Thank you very much. I am very much thankful to all higher authorities of Pune Vidyarthigruhas College of Engineering and Technology and G.K. Patewani Institute of Management for giving me the opportunity to give you the lecture on the disaster management in this induction program. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Good morning, dear students, and a warm welcome to you all for this induction program organized by PVG's College of Engineering.